Living Seed Media brings to you God's Word, which is His comprehensive equipment for changing lives. May the Lord impact your heart as you encounter His Word. For further inquiry or counsel, contact Peace House, P.O. Box 971, Boko, Benue State, Nigeria. Telephone numbers 0703-036-3659, 0703-768-1198. Email address lsmedia@livingseed.org or visit our website at www.livingseed.org. Let us sit back and listen as the servant of God brings forth the word of life.
The Holy Spirit at work in revival. The Holy Spirit at work in revival labors. We're going to be looking at the grace, measures of grace, spiritual gifts, ministry gifts, administrations, spiritual authority, and spiritual warfare that has to do with the move of the Spirit at our time and in our generation. We have come to another crucial junction in the move of God on earth. I want you to know that what God is doing with us is not local and is not exclusive even with our lives. As God allows us to travel in different parts of the world, we have continuously confirmed that what God has been speaking among us has a global perspective. As we kept learning and talking about discipleship, when we started talking about the need for discipleship, it was looking like, what are they talking about? But I'm happy to report to you that several denominations are returning back onto the matter of intentional discipleship in preparing the body of Christ to function properly in this generation. You can imagine the Anglican Communion. They have adopted intentional discipleship and they are pushing and they are looking for whatever can be done. The Methodists, they are also returning back to their roots, saying, how can we get back onto effective discipleship? And as I go from one nation to another, sometimes we have several conferences and this issue has become recurrent. We have come to another crucial junction in the move of God on earth. The church started out with the outpouring of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost on the lives of those disciples whom Jesus had called to be with him in concerted discipleship. They were 12 who he made his apostles, and then they grew to 120 men and women who waited for the endowment of power from on high. You will remember that at that upper room in Acts chapter 2, when the Holy Spirit came down, the result of that shower of the Spirit on the earth has remained indelible until today. It was in that atmosphere of the Holy Spirit that all that became the instructions for the church came forth. Praise the Lord. I don't know whether some of you remember some years ago when we felt God was bringing us, and then he said, ever before we will move into crossing Jordan, there are instructions. And I remember we spent hours on what we call the Leviticus. And we're looking at the Leviticus of God's move. But all of that was prophetic at that time. Now we have come to that threshold. Whatever instructions we are picking now, they are instructions for immediate action. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus Christ. Every revival of the church ever since that time of Pentecost has been the fresh outpouring of the Spirit upon his people to move the purpose of God forward in that particular generation. What I'm saying is that any time the church experienced any revival, it is simply a fresh outpouring of the Holy Spirit again to move the purpose of God and the church forward. Every time. Actually, there will be no revival unless the Holy Spirit had been poured forth afresh upon many hearts that are hungry and thirsty for him. We have several records of several visitations over the years and from place to place. We can talk about the Hebrides revival. We can talk about Joseph Babalola's revival in Nigeria. We can talk about the Gindiri outbursts. Some of you were alive when something broke forth at Gindiri in Plateau State. And that outburst came around 1972, and it spread. Actually, it advanced the move of God in the northern part of Nigeria. When you go back to all of this, we can remember a divine visitation that came in Wales, which we call Welsh Revival, the Methodist Revival. All of this, when you go back to their histories, they were an outpouring of the Holy Spirit that came. Whether this lasted or they did not, it's not because the Holy Spirit did not come, but because men that were supposed to handle it, men that were supposed to walk with God, either they did not know what to do, or they quickly got themselves hijacked, sidelined, onto pursuing something contrary to the purpose of the outpouring. So it became very, very critical that we must sit back first to understand what is the purpose, what is the peculiarity that God had been speaking to us about this move. Most of the outpourings begin in small settings, and the vessels being used were ordinary, unassuming men and women God found for himself. Permit me to explain something quickly there. Most of the move of God, most of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit that possibly became worldwide or nationwide or tribe-wide started very small, possibly in an obscure place, and sometimes with ordinary men that nobody ever reckoned with. It is normal with God. God uses the nothings of this world to confound the mighty. So let me also say, should what God starts to do in your life appear to begin as a small spark, do not despise the days of small things. Is that a Bible verse in our passage of Zechariah chapter 4? Who has despised the day of what? Of small things, of little beginnings. Let us note that a mighty rain is usually beginning with a droplet. But because whenever we are talking about revival, we only report revivals when it has become very big, when it has become overwhelming, when so many big things are happening. That's when we think revival started. So it makes many of us never to learn our lessons, because we're always thinking big. We are not accepting the little sparks of grace, the little drops of mercy that God is releasing in preparing us for the bigger outpouring. So if God begins to move in your little heart and in your sitting room, and things that nobody thought could happen, God begins to do it, should we stop it? Should we quench it because it's not yet big? No. The mighty outpouring, most of them, they started with little droplets. May God help us in the name of Jesus Christ. It is just right for us to hear God declare to us again that what lies ahead of us and what He is calling us into cannot be done by power, by the power of man. And it cannot be done by the might of man. It is by my spirit, says the Lord. Mountains will melt and become plains. Hills shall be leveled and valleys shall be filled. Rough edges shall be made straight and stumbling blocks shall be uprooted in preparing the way of the Lord among His people. All this shall be done by my spirit, says the Lord. Hallelujah. We are anticipating and expecting that God, who is faithful and who never fails to fulfill His word, He will cause His spirit at work in us to again bring us into a dimension of His manifestation in the coming days, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Whereas God will continue to raise men and women to provide leadership among us, the move of God at this time shall not be centered on men. I want you to please mark that. Even though God, in His mercy, will continue to raise men and raise women to provide leadership among us, the move of God itself at this time shall not be centered on personalities. God is no longer looking for one man show. This move is not the move of shiny stars. God is deliberately looking how to build His body and how we are going to move together as one people to cause His glory to break forth on the face of the earth. I don't know whether I'm communicating properly with you. Are you hearing me? That this particular move of God is not going to emphasize a man. The emphasis is not going to be the man of God. We are going to study the word of God to see how it should be and how we should respond to what God is asking us to do. Amen. The Lord himself will work in us and through several of his children. It is a move to prepare each member of the body of Christ to function in their own space without any labeling. Please permit me to go over that. I trust that God will give us understanding. That God is going to prepare each member of the body of Christ, everyone. Yesterday night, as we were concluding, he said, ask the Lord rain in the time of latter rain, and he will make bright clouds, and he will pour forth upon everyone grass of the field. Every one of us, each one of you, you are going to drink from your own cup. There is something unique that the Spirit of God is releasing, and is uniquely about you. God is not going to make you an onlooker or an admirer or a mere praise singer of some certain brothers on the stage. This is a move of the body by the body of Christ. Hallelujah. It's a move to prepare each member of the body of Christ to function in their own space without any labeling. All right, thank you. Without any labeling or personal attention drawn to individuals. It is also a move that will build the body of Christ in the unity of our faith, till we all grow up into him in everything. Christ being formed in you is the strong focus of this move of God to prepare his people for the soon coming of the King. Praise the Lord. Let me be slow about this. Whereas many, many revivals were spoiled because it was labeled. All the men that God was using, they were going with their own label. The question they were asking, which one is your own? Which one is your own? What is the name of your own ministry? So everybody began to label. And as we begin labeling into the work of God, we began to divide what God wanted to do by the names, by the labelings that we are putting. And unconsciously, we began to damn the Spirit move of God. So when she began this morning and began to prepare us to pray that the ruins in the body of Christ, we need to pray and repent about it, I just knew in my heart that God was confirming that we need to prepare and teach very deliberately that what God is about to do now is not about personality cult. It's not about dividing the work of God according to the number of brothers, sisters, pastors, ministers that God may want to use. How God will help this move? Not to end in another small monument. How it's going to be a move that will affect all denominations, all that is named after the name of Christ. How it will jump even into denominations that appear to be closed. How God will work so much that there shall be no more among us that kind of division, such that just as we have been sitting here, we have sat here for days, we have been living and studying the word of God, and we have not come from one denomination. Yet the body of Christ is real. When I sat back and I'm looking at what God is doing, my mind is overwhelmed. Because this thing that God is doing, we must not tamper with it. We must not derail it. We must take time to understand. If I tell you that there are people, there are denominations that on their own, they wrote check. They say MLR is our meeting. And they are sending check. They say our members are coming. We know that they are going to be fed. We are going to live together. So this is our own contribution. And I'm looking back, I say, God, this thing will belong to the body of Christ. Did you hear me very well? All these things, the body of Christ will come and collect it. They will own it. It will be their property. That's why, if Equa people want to come here and use this for their conference, it's free of charge. Because it belongs to them. When any group decided, the Anglican say, we want to come, we are bringing our clergy. I say, come. It's your own. It doesn't belong to us. We ourselves, we belong to the body of Christ. But when I go on in this teaching, we will be looking at the Bible. How should the body of Christ operate when the Holy Ghost comes? Don't worry about, can it happen? It's already happening. I see God doing it in a manner that is beyond us. I see the Holy Spirit doing something that is beyond explanation. Me, I am persuaded that God has started something. Nobody can quench it. It's an unstoppable move of God. Hallelujah. Since I don't have the time to tell you stories, let me go on with what I'm doing. But I just want to tell you, there's already a sound of abundance of rain. It is already. Already. Those of you that are Methodists, you will bear me record that our prelate, the prelate of the Methodist Nigeria, as soon as that Baba was consecrated, it was here he came. Among all other clergy. And we were all here together. Dancing and praying and crying together. And When you go anywhere and you meet the Anglicans, you will know that something has happened. The K and S, they are part of this move. God is doing what you don't know. Members of Celestial Church are putting aside things and they are saying, this thing is affecting our lives. We have trained many of their pastors. As you sit in Millet, you don't know whom you are sitting with. This fire is going everywhere. Nobody can stop it. Oh, the Catholics, they are here. Sometime, not to cause confusion so that there's no problem somewhere, we don't bring people up and say, come and talk. We know where we are going. One day, the Pope will join this move. It's not about, listen, it's not about us. It's that God is arising to take his church to the next level. There are things that are already happening that I want you to take note of. God is moving. This move is not about one man. It's about Jesus wanting to perfect what he began to do at Calvary. May God make you part of it. In the name of Jesus Christ. Why this revival? We bring in several souls. As it is the harvest time of ingathering. Its purpose and focus is the body of Christ being built up and being prepared to function on earth and in readiness for the appearing of our Lord and Master Jesus Christ. This is the peculiarity of this move. Several other revivals, though supposedly in pursuit of the salvation of souls, were hijacked to build around the men and the women God used as his vessels and vehicles, till it lost hold of the building of the bride for which Christ died and rose again. Disciples are to be made for Christ rather than personality cults of praise singers around the preachers and ministers of our time.